Harper Perennial and Harper Audio present Family Pictures, a novel by Sue Miller, performed by Vivienne Lainey. Part 1. Chapter 1. It's my brother Mac's birthday. He's 14. We're all sitting at the table in the dining room. The curtains are drawn, though you can see the glint of summer evening light through the cracks. When my mother rounds the corner from the kitchen with a glowing cake, we burst into ragged song. Heaped next to Mac's place on the table are his opened presents, odd homemade things from me and my younger sisters, but a nice sweater my mother gave him on behalf of my other brother, and three Roy Orbison 45s from my older sister Liddy. You can also see the neck of the guitar my parents have bought him, leaning against the table's edge. It seems to me that color rises to Mac's face as we sing to him, though perhaps it's just the soft light from the candles that makes him look this way. Young, and suddenly sweet and shy. When my eyes meet his, I'm embarrassed. I feel a catch in my voice. The moment we finish the song, Mac leans forward and blows the candles out. In the silent twilight aftermath of our applause, my other brother, my autistic brother Randall, speaks. "Happy birthday, dear Mackie," he says. We are all silent. And then Liddy, the oldest, laughs.
"My God," she says. "Did you hear him? My God."
"I wouldn't get excited, Lydia," my father says. "That's about his annual quota of words, isn't it?" And my mother's face, which has turned in astonishment to her younger son in the dim light, instantly drops. My father changes the subject. Someone gets up to pull back the curtains on the windows to let what's left of the daylight in. This is the way I remember it. But I'm wrong. My mother tells me he never spoke after the age of 4 or so. My sister Liddy says it's her memory, her story. One she told me much later. "I've appropriated it," she says, "the way I do with everything in our family's history. I've changed it to suit myself, made myself older, an observer, when in reality I was an infant when it happened, and Mary and Sarah weren't even born." And yet, it seems as clear to me as a picture I might have taken. I could swear this was exactly what happened. But that's the way it is in a family, isn't it? The stories get passed around, polished, embellished. Liddy's version, or Mac's version, changes as it becomes my version. And when I tell them, it's not just that the events are different, but that they all mean something different too. Something I want them to mean, or need them to. And of course, there's also the factor of time, of how your perspective, your way of telling the story, of seeing it, changes as time passes, as you change. Now, for example, I see that we must always have known, my younger sisters and I, that we hadn't been wanted or planned, that there was something complicated and painful for our parents in our very existence. But what we would have said then was just that there were too many of us, too many children in our family. So this might be one place to start my version of our story. How we felt about ourselves in our world, where every house spilled kids into the Chicago street. Most of them spilled 2 or 3, though. 4 was a little excessive. 5? Absurd. And there were 6 of us. 6 meant something different. A special case in some way. Catholic. Or a man who couldn't keep his hands off his wife. A neurotic breeder of a woman. People would ask, six of you? And yes, never seemed a sufficient answer. Occasionally I would say of myself and my younger sisters, well, we're the extras. Passing along one of our father's nicknames for us without understanding it, as though it might answer the question. And sometimes it seemed to. Oh, the questioner would say. Yes. Certainly even then we thought of the family as neatly divided down the middle. The first three, Macklin, Lydia, and Randall, were the special ones. Even those names, we thought, showed greater imagination, greater involvement on our parents' part than ours did. Nina, Mary, and Sarah. Clearly by that time they had run out of gas. But we didn't necessarily connect any of this with our father's nicknames for us. These were embarrassing, not because of what they meant, which none of us stopped to consider then anyway, but because they existed at all. Not because they pointed to some quality we shared, but because they pointed to us. He called us the unexpected guests, or the surprise party. He would lower his book and watch us as we passed his study door, the three of us always together. Under his high, narrow forehead, his blue eyes had the trick that eyes in certain portraits or photographs do, of seeming to follow you while actually remaining steady, unmoving. There they go, the extras, he'd say. Or, ah, the Fleetson, the Nina, the pint-sized, the Santa Maria. We were the little pitchers of health, the coup de grace, the last straws. We complained and laughed and whined about it. We told our mother, but it only made him worse. Pay no attention to him, Mother said when she was in a good mood. But when she was in the dumps, her mouth went tight. She would turn away from him quickly in anger. She'd pick up again whatever she was drinking, cold, milky coffee, flat beer, an inch or two of something brown and sticky in the bottom of a glass. I don't know why you imagine they're never going to understand you, she said once to him. Someday, out of the blue, you know they will. And then what, Lainey? He asked. And when she didn't answer, he said, the truth shall set you free. But there was no moment out of the blue, no revelation. It didn't happen that way. And though I did feel a strange sense, a sense that ran through my childhood, of being yoked to my sisters, of having some meaning as a group that had nothing to do with who I was alone or intended to be. Still, what my father said remained as meaningless, as much a part of unexamined family habit, as when my mother called one of us Honey Bunch or Sweetie Pie. Who would dream of asking what these meant literally? In fact, it wasn't until years later, long after I already knew the sad story of how we got here, that I realized what the nicknames referred to. That I understood he'd been joking about it with us since we were small. Affectionately, ruefully, he'd dared to make fun of the awful way we'd come into the world, the way he'd felt about us before we were people. And we'd heard only the affection, paid attention only to his tone. Ah, the unexpected blessings, he'd say, mockingly, tenderly. Let's count 'em. One, two, three. Nope. In my version of our story, it was always my mother, boozy or jittery from too much coffee, who made us feel strange when we were small. It was her intense loving that frightened us, her desperate quick embraces, her sudden anger, her internal combustion engine, my father called it. A set of mysterious private emotions which ruled her. You could never tell in what direction she'd suddenly veer. My father, tall and sober and steady, would listen to me, to all of us. In spite of the teasing, the sense of mockery in much of what he said, He seemed reliably connected to the world of events in a way our mother didn't, then or later. He knew the names of stars, of galaxies. He knew what berries you could eat and which were poisonous. It was he who explained to me, with a little chart he sketched on a paper napkin, the Mendelian laws, which dictated that probably one of Impey's kittens, like her, would have no tail, two would have half tails, and one would have a tail the length of any other cat's. Because he was a doctor, it was he who sat at the edge of the bed when one of us felt sick, who touched our foreheads for the heat of fever, who looked for white blisters on our throats, or the toss of red splotches on our bodies. His hands were cool and dry. But that changes over time, too. He moved out for a while when I was 12, and for me, after that, his magic seemed to vanish. This was partly because, though he sometimes had Mac or Liddy over alone, when I went, I was always invited with my two younger sisters. At that time, I was eager to be thought of as different from them, more grown up. And this didn't seem fair to me. It was true that the first few times we visited were like an adventure. His new apartment was clean and bare. I had never seen such rooms, uncluttered by what I'd always understood to be the necessary, the normal furniture of family life. There was a bunk bed and a fold-out couch in the extra bedroom, so we could all sleep together, a treat for us. For dinner, he usually fixed us what he called his spécialité de l'appartement. Runny omelets, crammed with mysterious flavors he wouldn't tell us the names of, but which we all loved. But then, very quickly, really, it got boring. We began to find things to grouse about to each other. We never had exactly the books or drawing things or dress-ups we wanted. We couldn't get any real projects going because he wanted it all picked up before we went to bed. And strangest of all, the teasing seemed awful. Embarrassing without the others there, without Mother, to hear it, to be amused or offended. Three wasn't enough for my father. His gifts required an audience, a larger house. He seemed to feel it too. He often phrased his invitations in the negative. "I don't suppose you'd like to come over and keep an old man company," he'd say. "I guess you're probably too busy to have dinner tonight." And as time went on, he asked us less and less. And what I felt about this shift, I realized after a while, was pure relief. Relief that my father, whom I'd loved more dearly than anyone in my family, seemed to have forgotten us, the extras. I can remember that moment, the moment when I knew that sharply and clearly. It was summer. I had been sent by my mother to get my brother Mac from Steinway's drugstore, where he liked to hang around. I was walking down 57th Street toward the university, running my hand along the top of a dusty, squared-off privet hedge. And all of a sudden, here was my father, walking toward me on the other side of the street. He was alone, moving fast. He had his jacket off, hooked on a finger over one shoulder, and his tie was dancing out to the side. I stopped to watch him, and I nearly called out. But at the last minute, I decided not to. He did look over as he hurtled along. He glanced quickly my way. But nothing about me stopped his moving eyes or slowed his motion. He kept walking. He passed by me on his side of the street. I turned to watch him striding away, the swing of his jacket across his back, the lilting alternation of his legs and blue-striped seersucker. And what I felt was gladness that he hadn't really seen me, that I'd not had to talk to him, that he hadn't even recognized his daughter in this adolescent girl on the street.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.